Please join in singing our opening hymn, Table of Plenty, number 311.
Lord Jesus, living bread from heaven, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Christ Jesus, cup of salvation, Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord Jesus, source of nourishment and grace, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, God of heaven.
Let us pray. O God, who in this wonderful sacrament have left to us the memorial of your passion, grant us, we pray, so to revere the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may always experience in ourselves the fruits of your redemption, who live and reign with God the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "Remember how for 40 years now the Lord your God has directed all your journeying in the desert, so as to test you by affliction and find out whether or not it was your intention to keep his commandments. He therefore let you be afflicted with hunger, and then fed you with manna, a food unknown to you and your fathers, in order to show you that not by bread alone does one live, but by every word that comes forth from the mouth of the Lord. Do not forget the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, that place of slavery, who guided you through the vast and terrible desert with its seraph serpents and scorpions, its parched and waterless ground, who brought forth water for you from the flinty rock and fed you in the desert with manna, a food unknown to your fathers." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
Glorify the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion. For he has strengthened the bars of your gates. He has blessed your children within you.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
He has granted peace in your borders. With the best of wheat, he fills you. He sends forth his command to the earth. Swiftly runs his word.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
He has proclaimed his word to Jacob, his statutes and his ordinances to Israel. He has not done thus for any other nation. His ordinances he has not made known to them. Alleluia.
Praise the Lord, Jerusalem.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, the cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because the loaf of bread is one, we, though many, are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read along the sequence together. Lo, the angel's food is given to the pilgrim who has striven. See the children's bread from heaven, which all dogs may not be spent. Truth, the ancient types fulfilling, Isaac bound, a victim willing. Paschal lamb, its lifeblood spilling, manna to the Father sent. Very bread, good shepherd, tend us. Jesu, of your love, befriend us. You refresh us, you defend us. Your eternal goodness send us in the land of life to see. You who all things can and know, who on earth such food bestow, grant us with your saints the lowest, where the heavenly feast you show, fellow heirs and guests to be. Amen. Alleluia.
Jesus said to them, Amen, amen, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you do not have life within you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I have life because of the Father, so also the one who feeds on me will have life because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Unlike your ancestors who ate and still died, whoever eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Just slightly over 22 years ago, I was ordained a deacon in the Catholic Church, which expanded my role that I inherited at baptism and confirmation to teach the faith. But one of the things I was taught was that the homily is not usually intended for direct instruction, but sometimes I believe it becomes imperative. I read a couple of articles this week which indicate maybe this is one of those times. They claim that at least one-third of Catholics do not believe in the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist, either through ignorance of church teaching or by choice. Jesus once condemned those who lead others astray, and not to say something at this time, I feel is tantamount to leading you astray, and gives merit to my confession in the confidio, the things that I do not do. So what better time than the feast day of this most blessed sacrament? Church teaching is that in the smallest crumb or drop of the Eucharist is contained the whole of God. The real, not symbolic, body, blood, soul, and divinity of the Son, whose sacrifice brings us salvation. Formally, she calls it the source and summit of our very faith. It is a dogma of our faith, that is, a belief that is unnegotiable. To not believe is not, and I repeat, not to be in communion with the Holy Catholic Church. But even more critically comes a grim warning in Scripture. For the one who eats and drinks judgment upon themselves if they do not properly recognize the body. Many translations call it what it is, damnation. In church language, mortal sin. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, no one can make you believe. You must discover this truth through faith, study, discernment, and prayer. But if you are among the non-believers, or even having doubts, I urge you, for your very soul, to talk with a priest. In the late 1960s, I was dating a young woman who just happened to be Catholic. And I decided to study the Catholic faith to better understand where she was coming from. Now, a piece of background, her mother was not one of my favorite or biggest fans. But even though she herself was not Catholic, she was in heart, mind, belief, and resolve. So I had an alternative motive to disprove what her precious church was all about. But like so many before me who set out to discredit the church, I not only discovered truth, but I came to believe that the one holy apostolic and Catholic church was the best opportunity to realize the promises of our God and to achieve eternal life. I converted not for the young lady who could be here today or gone tomorrow, but because I believed. And by the way, if you need any details, you can ask the girl. She's not my wife. And maybe this will help you who are struggling with any of the teachings of the Catholic Church. I converted, but there were still a couple of gray areas I struggled with. And so instead of risking being at least a hypocrite, and at worst a blatant sinner, I stepped outside of my pride and took my concerns to the priest. Fortunately, they were patient and eventually explained everything in a way that I could accept to reconcile my doubts. And don't get discouraged. It didn't happen overnight, because a large part of my heritage is Swedish, a people known for being stubborn. I have since had the great honor of distributing communion to countless people, but one of the most memorable happens to be a first. The excitement and wonder on the boy's face were priceless. And it was no surprise, because from the time he finished his preparation, he had been anticipating this day. And it got delayed because he wanted to wait till Grandpa could be there to offer it with the priest to him for the first time. For a couple of months, all I heard was him reminding me of the day and the countdown to the event. Grandpa, do you know what happens on August 12th? Grandpa, it's only a week away. Grandpa, it's only 3 days till my first communion. Grandpa. Now, Daniel couldn't spout theology about what the Eucharist is or means, like Thomas Aquinas, or maybe even you and I. But he knows one thing to this day. It is Jesus, and very, very special. How I wish I saw the excitement in your faces each time you receive communion that I saw in his. Oh, how I pray that I would feel that same excitement and anticipation each time I receive the bread of life. The Emperor Napoleon was asked what the greatest day of his life was. And it was expected that he would mention one of his many victories. But he answered the day of his first communion. And I think it's vitally important to address the issues that arise for you. For correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe every Catholic should be able to trust that the Church has one purpose, to assist us in our relationship with God and in achieving eternal life. And herein is the practical reason why we must achieve sufficient understanding to be in communion with the Church. For how can we trust someone that we believe is teaching us wrong? And what statements of faith naturally are called into suspicion if we reject others? There are many scientifically verified stories surrounding the Eucharist that identify it as being mysterious and special. Miracles, healings, unexpected and baffling events. The Church has held throughout history that the Eucharist is extremely special, and countless people have given their very lives for this belief alone. She teaches that it is the real presence of Christ. Her teaching on it has not faltered, and it has not changed. It is a very special day the first time it happens, and it should be a very special day every time. We should step up to the minister each and every time with joy in our hearts, a smile on our face, and offer up our altar proudly to receive the real presence of our Lord. A medical doctor once shared with me, "It's too bad that we too often forget that this real presence of Christ that we consume is not destroyed, but becomes a part of every cell of our body. And isn't it a shame that recognizing that, we don't become what is so much a part of us, the real presence of Christ? That is the true purpose of this sacrament, not only to have life within us, but that of Christ, which transforms us." We've all heard other priests, deacons, and the faithful beautifully expound on the virtues of the Eucharist, and we too could spend endless time on the subject. It nourishes us, if we let it, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. And I challenge you to reread today's gospel. But Jesus calls it what it's meant to be for us, life. "For unless you eat this bread and drink this cup, you shall not have life within you." My only apology is to you who do believe this dogma of the Church, which I pray is all of you. And I trust my words were not a waste of your time. But God placed on my heart to be true to the spiritual works of mercy, to instruct and counsel. So if you are struggling with any teaching of the Church, do something about it, because it truly could be the difference between heaven and hell.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us place our trust in the Lord as we now present to him our prayers and intercession.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. That believers everywhere seek the Eucharist with greater faith, reverence, and desire, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the earth and the whole universe echo the beauty and love of the Eucharist, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those that live lives in loneliness and despair find comfort in the Eucharist, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That fathers, especially those that have buried a child, be strengthened and nourished by the Eucharist, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And that these followers of Jesus become more like him through frequent reception of communion, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And that we may intercede for one another as we mention our many needs and intentions in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, in your merciful love, we ask you to hear all our prayers and grant them according to your will, for we ask all this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we receive the bread we offer you, fruit to the earth and work of human hands, to become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we receive the wine we offer you, fruit to the vine and work of human hands, and become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Grant your church, O Lord, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace, whose signs are to be seen in mystery, in the offerings we here present, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. or at the Last Supper with his apostles, establishing for the ages to come the saving memorial of the cross, he offered himself to you as the unblemished lamb, the acceptable gift of perfect praise, nourishing your faithful by the sacred mystery. You make them holy so that the human race, bound by one world, may be enlightened by one faith and united by one bond of charity. And so we approach the table of this wondrous sacrament, so that bathed in the sweetness of your grace, we may pass over to heavenly realities here foreshadowed. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we, with all the hosts of angels, cry out, without end, we acclaim. So that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Taking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Edward our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen.
our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer to each other.
Let us offer one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Peace be with you. Away the sins of the world, blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him, says the Lord. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray that we may delight for all eternity in that share in your divine life, which is foreshadowed in the present age by our reception of your precious body and blood, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And let us go in peace to love and serve our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our closing hymn is number 732, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.